as I go. I go with just a few words left to say. I truly have enjoyed being your quarterback. Baby, you a song and you made me want to roll my
windows down. This is the test, right? This is the test. Can you put it behind you, right? Can you put the last two plays behind you? Right, move on to the next one and go out and do our jobs, right? Our defense is kicking out there. We got to pick it up for them, right? Everybody check themselves. We know the plan, right? Let's run the ball. Things will open up off that. Let's play our tempo, all right? Let's go.
Now, it's your Tuesday morning quarterbacks.
That's what I'm talking about, all right? Let's go.
On News Talk 1270 KIML.
Let's quit waiting to the third series, right? Let's go. Sense of urgency from here on out, right? Let's go. Keep making plays. Let's go.
Don Carpenter.
Except you. I can't even look at you.
And Chad Franz.
Go sit in the portal there for 20 minutes. That's right. Just stay in there. We were falling in love. Sweetheart of summer. She hopped right
up into the cab of my truck and said, fire it up. Good morning. Welcome to Tuesday morning quarterbacks.
Yeah, hey, good morning.
Well, it seems like you were just in here.
It does seem that way.
Well, this is what is it, 20 minutes ago, I guess.
Yeah, great to be back. It's our second Tuesday morning quarterback show. Busy day today.
We got
a bunch of Gillette College rodeo team members coming in a few minutes. And right now we're pleased to be joined by Gillette Wild head hockey coach Tom Winkler.
How's it going, guys?
Hey, coach. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
You guys are, you're 3-1 now?
3-1,
after four games? How do you feel like the season's been going?
Well, it's, we're coming along. It's, we're a young team. We lost a lot of guys from last year. I think we're excited with the early results, but we still got a lot of work to do. We still got a lot of learning and teaching. And, it's a fun group to work with, very good group of kids, very receptive, very coachable. And obviously we've made some huge strides in a short period of time.
When you say you lost a lot of guys from last year, how much turnover do you typically have?
Normally, I guess you'd like to have between 12 and 13 guys back from last year's team. And, this year we're sitting at 8 guys. We had 13 guys last year that actually aged out, that moved upward and onward to schools and other avenues. And then with some of our younger players, we actually moved on as well. So, it's a very it's a developmental level. So you hope to have your kids for 2 years, but some of them come in, play for a year, and move upward and onward, and that's the scenario that we had. And we did have an older team last year. Our first year as an expansion team, 3 seasons ago, we were fortunate that majority of those kids wanted to come back for the second season, and that's why we ended up with a little bit older group last year. But this team is coming with an identity of their own. They're like I said, they're a fun group to work with. They compete every day at practice, and our goal is to get better every day and every week. And so far, we have no criticisms of that.
When you look at the personalities and the talent on this team, what would you say is the identity that you envision for this team?
It's a scrappy group. We don't have a guy like we had last year with Taylor Motzinger, who's going to put hundreds of points on the board. I mean, majority of our games, we've outshot our opponents 2 and sometimes even 3-1, and we're winning 4-2, 2-0, scores like that. So I think we're going to be an extremely hardworking team, but we're going to have to win games, like I said, 2-0, 3-2. 2-1, because we're playing good defense and then capitalizing. And obviously we'd like to get another pure finisher so we could maybe score a few more goals a game. But, that's kind of the identity. They're scrappy, gritty, hardworking kids.
You started out the season 2-1 on your 3-game setup there in Montana. And then you returned home this last Friday for your home opener against Billings, and you won that one 2-0. How did that one go?
It was a great night. It was, a fantastic crowd as usual. I mean, we really do have great community support, and it's a very tough building for opposing teams to come in and play in. And you know what? It was one of those games where I felt after the first period we could have probably been up 3 or 4-0, but we were up 1-0. A little bit of a drop off in the second period, but we got out of the period, you know, with the, you know, with them not scoring and still up by a goal. And then our veteran captain, Brandon Miller, got an unassisted goal a couple minutes into the third period, which, you know, gave us a little bit of breathing room. But, you know, that's a game that, you know, it would have been nice to have, you know, three or four more goals. And, you know what, but we did. We played really good shutdown defense, and we slowed them down through the neutral zone and frustrated them. You know, so, I mean, again, just a typical – kind of a typical win for how we're going to have to do things right now.
Pretty good atmosphere there on your opening night?
No, it was fantastic. Fantastic.
What kind of a crowd?
It was about 840, I think, was the final tally.
Okay.
So it was loud. It was, you know, just – it really is. It's a neat environment for these kids to play in. I mean, some of these kids have played in junior programs where there's 20, 30 people at a game, and then they come in here and experience this town and this community and kind of are like, man, I should have been here a couple years ago.
What's the age range for the guys on your team?
16 to 20.
So you got some high school kids, I'm guessing, and then yep. How does that go?
We've got four high school kids this year. You know, obviously the school system is fantastic, and these kids transfer in with relatively ease, get their schedule set up, and go through the routine. The rest of the guys, if they're not actively a full-time high school student, they either have to have a part-time job or they have to take a decent credit load at Gillette College. And a lot of these guys, for NCAA eligibility, they can't take more than they can't be a full-time student. So a lot of them take between 6 and 8 credits per semester.
The kids who are, say, 16, for example, some of them aren't from here, so they aren't just from here, grow up here, and then go to high school. You've brought them in from somewhere else in some cases?
Absolutely. Yeah, we've got kids from all over the United States.
And then how does that work? Have they just been growing up playing hockey and they wanted to – and they just wanted to branch out?
Well, yeah, either that. I mean, we do have a good core of local kids, but, you know, we do have to go out and spend a lot of time in the spring and summer recruiting, go into showcases and tryout camps at the Tier 2 level and things of that nature. And, you know, obviously when we sit down and get an opportunity to talk to a kid, we present what the opportunity is here. And, you know, a lot of times they want to come and experience it and move up to a different level from where they were playing at, or take that next step, and this is usually it.
Why don't you run through some of your primary contributors this year, if you could?
TJ McMinn has had a real nice start for us. He's a returner, came in last year, had a developmental year last year, and he's really responded with a very, very good start. Darren Banks is back. Banks, he's probably the... in my opinion, one of the strongest players in the league on his skates. He's an unbelievably strong kid, huge physical presence, you know, plays with an edge, plays tough. Obviously, he's a big part of us. We picked up a defenseman, Greg Sowers. Greg is a player that I saw a few years ago that I had recruited heavily for 2 years straight, and finally we were able to get him out here. And I mean, he's a veteran. He's very poised. He a good leader. He fills a leadership role that we lost with a lot of our guys leaving. So we obviously expect big things of him. Moco Willis is back, off to a strong start in league play. Had kind of a slow start in training camp, but he's really bounced back and is really playing with a purpose right now. And he's an unbelievable talent. You know, Brandon Castleberry, another local player that's we expect big things from. You know, I could go through this list. I mean, a lot of these guys, they all bring something different to the table. You know, when you put a team together in any sport, we always kind of use the analogy, it's like baking a cake. You got to have a bunch of different ingredients and in this case, a different types of players to fit roles and to do certain things. And you're successful when you have guys accept and buy into their role and do what the team needs them to do to be successful. And we've got a good group of this. I mean, you know, Jonathan Kasdorf is a Canadian player. We got, I saw him at a North American League camp, and I actually thought he played extremely well at that camp and didn't really get the look that I thought he should have, and he ends up coming here, and he's just been, you know, he's a very, very gritty, stay-at-home, you know, plays tough but yet can skate and move the puck. So we really have a wide variety of different players and what they do, and again, so far it's, you know, it's gelling pretty well.
How many locals?
Let's see. We've got 1, 2, 3. About 6.
All right.
Yeah.
That sounds good.
Yep.
So you got six locals, and then you're off on the road this weekend.
Yeah, we head out to Great Falls. We've got a two game set with them Friday, Saturday. You know, they're I think early on they're probably going to be one of the better teams in the league this year. I think they've got a lot of kids back from last year. They're well coached. You know, they kind of went through some growing pains last year because they were a younger team last year. But having that year of experience under their belt, we're going to have our hands full. We've got to be ready to play. And you know, one of the things that we are talking about, and I'm looking at the stat sheet that you gave us, but we got to cut down on our penalty minutes. We got a couple guys that are up there already, and obviously we want our guys to play with an edge and play physical, but I think we got to smarten up a little bit, and I think we've got to cut down on the penalties. Again, you give a team like Great Falls several power play opportunities, and, you know, it's going to come back and hurt you. So,
is there a penalty that's been plaguing you guys, or has it just been penalties racking up?
You know, I think I would just have to say we've taken three major penalties in our first four games, which are those are 5-minute power plays where the opposition can score at will. It doesn't get negated if a goal is scored, and that's a lot of time. And when you're killing that much penalty time, it gets your lines out of sync. There are guys that don't kill penalties, so they're not playing. So it really just kind of throws everything into it throws you out of order and out of whack. So again, it's about discipline and, quite frankly, you know, smartening up and you know, making sure we're not crossing the bounds here.
Is putting yourself on defense, you know, just killing penalties, is that more taxing energy wise than maybe just playing straight up?
Absolutely, it is. Absolutely, and obviously it's a benefit for a team that has a 5-minute power play. I mean, they basically are in charge of that 5 minutes on the ice because you're a man down and you're usually chasing and reacting instead of dictating and controlling the play, and that's what we like to do.
Yeah, now you mentioned the team was scrappy and it's a little bit more of a defensive-minded team. I mean, do you think that kind of contributes to the style that's drawing all these penalties?
I do.
A little bit more physical style when you're playing like that, especially if you're trying to slow people through the neutral zone. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
But how are the rules in this level? I mean, do they allow the trap or anything like that?
Well, no, it's opened up. The game has opened up, you know, like it is in the National Hockey League. I mean, there's no obstruction and things of that nature. And you're right. You know, when you are playing tighter defense, you are more physical. You are engaged in one-on-one battles more. But, you know, our biggest thing is you know, you look at pro hockey and hockey in general right now, and everybody's, you know, and rightfully so, the concern and focus is on the head injuries and the head contact
and
the dangerous plays. And I think, you know, we're kind of seeing, you know, and this is maybe a little bit of a soapbox, but this generation of player is certainly a lot more reckless than they were 15, 20 years ago. The equipment's better, you know, so there's a sense of fearlessness and a sense of I'm not going to get hurt. And I think, you know, as coaches down at the youth level, we've got to do a better job of teaching our guys that, you know, you got to eliminate the hits from behind. You got to eliminate the blind side and the dangerous plays, and you got to eliminate the headshots. And I think our league is trying to do a very good job, just like all the other leagues are, of policing that better. And we've had a couple situations where guys have missed games because they have hit an opposing player from behind. And, you know, whether there's injury or not, there usually is a game suspension that goes along with that. And it's a teaching point and a learning point. And I think some of our new guys are still going through the learning and the understanding of what they can and can't do, and the fact that there is a point of emphasis by the officials to cut down on this stuff. And I think, you know, again, the responsibility falls not only on the player, but it falls on the coaches to make sure that we're not doing that. And that's why I'm a little frustrated, because we have had a few hitting from behind penalties that have cost us some guys and you know, for some games, and that's where we've got to smarten up.
Right.
I mean, you can be aggressive and tough and physical, but not take penalties.
Now, how do you get that message through to a player, especially again on a little tighter playing defensive minded team? I'd imagine that it's kind of ingrained. I mean, some of these kids have probably been playing for 10 years already, at least, and it's kind of ingrained that you want to hit. And sometimes you do that hit from behind. How do you get through to the players that that's not okay?
Well, you know, obviously the techniques and how they do it needs to be taught. The, you know, we have a simple rule. If you see the number or you see the kid's name, you can't finish a hit. I mean, it's pretty simple. I mean, if you're going to finish a hit on a guy and you can clearly see the number and name on the back of his jersey, he's in a vulnerable position. And that responsibility falls back on the player that's throwing the hit to not put that kid in that situation. And you know, it's an emotional game. It's a fast game. And I think the big issue where guys have problems is a lot of times they're going to finish a guy who they see shoulder on, but he'll turn. He'll turn at the last second to avoid the hit or maybe think that he's softening the blow. And then when you follow through, you're still hitting that player in a vulnerable position.
So yeah, sometimes you want to turn your back because you know it's a little wider and it's a little bit better to take a blow. I mean,
you'd think
you don't lose your balance.
But at the end of the day, it does put you in a vulnerable spot because you are turning. In the act of turning, sometimes you come upward, and therefore your balance points aren't as solid, and you have guys going into the boards in awkward positions and awkward angles. Where if you just take the hit shoulder to shoulder and you know you're against the wall, you're, you know, the physiology of your body, your long bones are going to take and absorb the hit and you'll be fine. So I think it's kind of a responsibility on both ways, the player making the hit, but also, you know, the player who's being hit. And it's interesting, I have a few buddies who are officials in the National Hockey League, and they don't have a checking from behind rule in the National Hockey League. It's boarding. And I've always asked them, I'm like, why don't you just call it a hit from behind? And they're like, well, at this level, the guys are smart enough to not get themselves in that position. So they basically use boarding, and it does give them the officials a little bit more leeway as far as, you know, what they can do for game misconducts and ejections and things like that. But, you know, again, those guys are trained, and there's a little bit more, you know, again, of a respect level that we have to do a better job as coaches is teaching our guys to make sure they're not hitting these kids when they're invulnerable.
Right. And as a developmental league, that's the job of this level of hockey to teach good practices.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, you guys are you're on the road this weekend, and then when are you back home?
The following weekend. We got the Helena Bighorns coming to town the following weekend.
How can people get tickets for that?
Either through the website, which is GilletteWildHockey.com, or dropping by Wild West Hockey downtown, which is across the street from Brianna's Bakery.
NHL season starts today. Who you got?
Best day in hockey. Best day of the year. You know, it's I'm excited. You know, being from St. Louis, I bleed blue. I'm a true Blues fan, and you know, I think they've got some key components this year to where they can really make some noise. They've had a few rough postseasons, having to go up against the LA Kings the last couple of years, but I think they have potential to be a Final Four team. The Hockey News actually picked them to win the Stanley Cup, which means they won't. They've cursed them, but I'm excited. I think, you know, there's a lot of teams that have potential to really be good and cause some problems this year for, you know, you've got the Bostons and Chicagos and the LAs that are, you know, continually top teams. But I think, you know, you've got some teams that have turned the corner in Tampa Bay and Columbus, I think, is going to be good. You know, and then you've got a team like Ottawa that was on the cusp of doing some damage last year. And, of course, it pains me to say, but Detroit, I mean, they, you know, I think they probably had two of the best moves in the offseason, getting Steven Weiss from Florida and Daniel Alfredson from Ottawa for 1 year. I mean, that's a huge get. So they're obviously going to be competitive. And, you know, I think it's going to be fun. It's going to be a fun season.
All right, sounds good. Well, we'll look forward to having you in again, Coach Winkler.
Thank you.
I appreciate you coming in today. You're our first live guest here on Tuesday Morning Quarterbacks.
Awesome. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's Gillette Wild Coach Tom Winkler.
News Talk 1270 KIML.
It's happening in Wyoming. He's talking about it. Don Carpenter on News Talk 1270 KIML. Don Carpenter on News Talk 1270 KIML.
I need to get the liners done for this segment.
Yeah, we need to get one more thing done there. Hey, welcome back to Tuesday Morning Quarterbacks.
Yeah, good morning, and welcome to the studio. We have Christy Steffes and Jade Blackwell from the Gillette College rodeo team. Welcome.
Thank you.
So, well, Neither of us really know a whole lot about rodeo, so I think this is going to be a little bit of an educational experience. I'm an East Coaster. And at least Chad grew up in Colorado where you guys...
I don't know anything about rodeo.
Well, you grew up in Boulder, so that...
You guys are from South Dakota?
Yep.
What year are you guys here at Gillette College?
This is my sophomore year.
This is my first year here.
And Christy, you specialize in barrel racing, is that right?
Some weekends, yeah.
What else do you do?
Goat tying, breakaway roping, and team roping.
What's your favorite?
It depends on the weekend. Whichever one goes better.
What goes into barrel racing?
There's three barrels, and it's a timed event, and you run in a clover leaf pattern, and it's the fastest time wins.
What would you say is the most difficult?
I don't know. Probably the breakaway roping or goat tying.
There's no animals in barrel racing, is there?
No, there is.
Oh, there. Well,
yep.
So what do they do?
Run around the barrels.
Oh, I got you. Have you seen barrel racing, Don?
I've seen it on TV. Yeah. But now, I mean, how long have you guys been doing this? I'd imagine it takes years and years of practice.
Yeah.
I'd imagine.
Just really young.
I mean, I can barely ride a horse.
How did you get into it?
My family rodeoed, and I kind of just grew up around it.
What was the earliest you'd say you did a rodeo type thing?
Probably 5.
What about you, Jade?
Probably about the same, somewhere around there.
You're from Rapid City?
Yep.
And you're from Sturgis, mm-hmm. Christy? Is rodeo pretty big in those areas?
Yeah, it's pretty big around all of kind of where we're at.
Now, when you first get started at the age of 5, I mean, do you start with like the sheep busting where you ride the sheep? Is that how you got started?
I did do that, actually.
How did that go?
It was okay.
Mutton busting?
Yeah, mutton busting.
Yeah, there
like
you go.
Is that like a race? Or is it like sheep bucking?
Yeah, kind of like sheep bucking.
Yes.
What's your record for staying on a sheep?
Not very long.
Have you done mutton busting, Jade?
Yeah, I did one time.
Is that how you got into bareback riding and saddle bronc riding?
Yeah. Pretty much, I guess. I don't know. It's kind of just a fun thing to do when you're a little kid.
And then now you do bareback riding.
Saddle bronc.
I'm sorry. You do saddle bronc riding.
Yes, sir.
And you won this past weekend.
Yep, I did.
Where were you guys this past weekend? Sheridan?
Yeah, we're in Sheridan. It was pretty muddy down there. And so it was a pretty good rodeo.
The men's team took 2nd and the women's team took 1st. Is that right?
Yeah.
How did you do, Jade?
Well, I won it. It was, got on, first horse wasn't very good, had a re-ride the next day, and that turned out, and I won the first round, then had a nice colt in the 2nd round, and won the 2nd round, too, or a short round.
Very nice. So, saddle bronc riding, you got a bronc, and you got a saddle on it, and then what happens?
They have it in the chute, and they let it out, and they score the horse from, they have 2 judges on each side, 1 to 25. And then they mark the horse, like, if it's no good, it's down, like, lower towards up. And if it's really good, it gets closer to 25. And then they judge the rider, like, the spurring action, same thing, 1 to 25. And then they just add the 2 together.
And you're getting on a horse that you've never ridden before? Or is this the horse that you practice on all the time?
No, we've never. I mean, sometimes you've been on the same horse before, but most of the time.
But you don't have, a big connection with that specific horse?
No.
So it's also dependent on... your score's dependent on the horse, so you want to get a good lively horse, I'd imagine, right?
Yep. 50% of it's the horse.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you get a horse that's just lazy and doesn't mind people riding him, you're not going to get a very good score, I'd imagine.
What's tougher, staying on a bronc right now or staying on a sheep when you were a kid?
Oof. I don't know. I got knocked out more in the sheep riding than I had in the bronc riding.
So. Do sheeps get pretty crazy?
No, not really. I just was riding one, and we ran into the bucking chutes.
Yeah, well, I'd imagine at 5 years old, it's pretty tough to do. I mean, I couldn't. I know I couldn't. I could barely tie my shoes at 5 years old. So.
Oh yeah, staying on a sheep at 5 would be pretty difficult.
Yeah. So that's a pretty big accomplishment.
So then, have you done bareback riding before?
Yeah, I rode barebacks in high school, but I just did it for a couple of years, and it really wasn't for me.
What's the key to be a good saddle bronc rider? Do you have to stay in good shape?
No, I don't work out.
You just stay in good shape by doing that, probably.
Yeah, pretty much.
I would imagine you'd have to have a pretty good core.
Sometimes, yeah. But yeah.
He's mainly. Just modest.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but you're a big guy, so it probably helps a little bit.
Yeah, I just say believe in yourself is the hardest thing.
Well, and a lot of practice. I mean, I'd assume this takes a lot of practice.
Yeah, so, it takes quite a bit.
So, Christy, you took third in the barrel racing. How did that go for you?
It went good. It's a little harder when it's muddy. It kind of slows the horses down, but
it was muddy up there.
Yeah, my horse handled it well, and it was good.
Very nice. What else do you do then?
The goat tying and breakaway roping and team roping.
And what's your favorite?
Probably the breakaway roping or the barrels.
I'm sorry, I don't even know what breakaway roping is.
It's you ride a horse in that too, and there's a calf in the chute, and they let the calf out, and you rope the calf, and whoever's fastest wins.
How much practice does that take?
A lot.
I would imagine.
Well, now you get to ride your own horse for the for the roping events. So at least you have that kind of connection.
Yes.
So, and again, I mean that's the roping event that I'm familiar with. I mean, the team roping, you have, I guess, a couple guys, mm-hmm. and you have to get the horse down or is it a goat or a steer?
Yeah.
Okay, so you get him down and you have to get him tied up and everything. So
how long did that take?
A lot of teamwork.
How long did it take you to rope your first calf? From the time you tried it, approximately.
Well, I practiced on a dummy for a long time, so I kind of had an idea.
Okay.
I just chased a calf, so I don't know. It took a while, probably.
Wow, I don't think I could ever do that.
No.
I'd probably fall off the horse when I tried to put the rope out there.
Well, see, that's the thing. You fall off a horse, you just got to get back up on there. I mean, that's one thing. I mean, my daughter does some horseback riding. She doesn't do rodeo. I think she wants to. But, you know, in Pennsylvania, there's not a whole lot of rodeo going on. So, you know, maybe I'll get her to come out here one of these days.
So, you guys are here for a couple of years probably at Gillette College. And then do you hope to do rodeo after that?
This will probably be my last year here. I just kind of came back just to college rodeo, but plan to keep going after this.
Okay. What about you, Christy?
I don't know. This is my second year, and I don't know. I might go somewhere else next year and finish out.
Like another school?
Yeah.
And do college rodeo?
Yeah.
Do most schools offer rodeo, or are there ones that you have your eye on?
A lot of schools do. I haven't really thought about it right now.
Okay. And then can you compete professionally as a rodeo athlete? You plan on doing that?
We both do already.
Oh, you both do already?
Oh, wow.
Wow. Okay.
So and what's your majors over at Gillette College? Just
I'm a social science major.
Social, okay. And just general studies right now?
Yeah, okay. I used to go down in Fort Scott, Kansas, and they took agriculture down there, but they don't really offer much of that here, so it's kind of
surprising for this area, isn't it?
Yeah.
But hey, you get, it's a good rodeo team, though. I mean, mm-hmm.
really
you guys
good.
Are doing really well. So it puts you in a little bit upper tier, so, you know, if you want to get noticed by a four-year school, you can, so.
And you guys head out to Lamar, Colorado this weekend. Do you have any more home rodeos?
Not really. We'll go to Cheyenne the weekend after, and then Gillette's college rodeo isn't until this spring.
Oh, gotcha. Well, that'll be a long trip to Lamar.
Yeah.
How many trailers do you guys haul out there?
Oh, I think five or six, maybe.
And it's about a nine-hour drive, probably?
Yeah.
That's a long day.
Well, hey, thanks so much for coming in. Best of luck.
Oh, thank you,
guys.
This weekend and the rest of the time here.
Yeah, thanks a lot, guys, and hopefully we'll get to see you again sometime soon.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
That's Jade Blackwell and Christy Steffes from the Gillette College Rodeo Team.
Okay, when we come back, we'll do the top five NFL teams.
9:45.
Yeah, 9:40. Well, it'll be about 9:47, but that's all right.
Either way.
News Talk 1270 KIML.
Broadcasting from two tall towers in the middle of a big field.
John Carpenter on News Talk 1270 KIML.
Time now for your weekly NFL Power Rankings.
That's unbelievable!
Where is Tonya Harding when you need her?
Oh, it's a scene, man.
We have a party like 1955.
Do you ever just get down on your knees and thank God that you know me and have access to my dimension?
It's the top five at 9:45.
Well, it's not really 9:45, but that's all right.
Either way.
We have plenty of time, I think.
Close enough.
Yeah, it's close enough. So, I guess we should get started. I mean, my top five, this week it's pretty easy because there are only five undefeated teams.
Yeah, there are five undefeated teams, so we'll pretty much rank who we think is the best and who we think is the worst.
Yeah,
My number five team in terms of the top five is the New Orleans Saints, who just beat the Dolphins last night.
Okay.
Saints, no. The reason I have them at number five is basically because they struggled on defense all year last year.
Well, yeah, that kind of makes sense. I have them ranked a little. I actually have them ranked a lot higher, but that's all right. That's all right. I mean, they proved a lot to me last night.
They got Rob Ryan coordinating their defense. He, I guess, is an upgrade over whoever they had. Oh, they had Steve Spagnuolo last year. He may be an upgrade over Steve Spagnuolo, but he kind of flamed out in Dallas. So I guess I don't have a whole lot of faith in Rob Ryan. That's why I have the Saints as my number five team. Don, what about you?
And my number five? Okay, I should turn it up.
Down, goal to go at the two. 17-7 Kansas City, 5:50 to go in the game.
You know,
they
it's
bring
skipped.
McCluster in motion. They fake to him. Sprint out action.
Okay.
It didn't play, so I...
Okay.
Can we go back to number five?
Let's see. Da-da-da-da. Okay, let me see if I can add it real quick here. Okay.
This is our first time doing the top five at 9:45 segment.
Okay.
The best laid plans.
Yeah.
What they say about the best laid plans.
Live radio for you. Okay. And let's see here. Put the stops in between them.
Can you move? Yeah, there you go.
Okay, let's try this again. Here's my number five.
Number five. Ryan under center. Two receivers wide side left. Deep drop for the quarterback. Rainbows down the right side. Tlaib has the inside leverage. Makes the grab. Interception, New England. Inside the 45. He was stride for stride in front of Julio Jones. And he's got his fourth interception in the last three games.
Tlaib's played great for us all year. You know, all the way back to the spring training camp. You know, he's stepped up in every game. And played well. Played the ball well. You know, played against good receivers. And he's... You know, he's tackled well, he's covered well, so he's done a good job for it.
Yeah, the New England Patriots.
Yeah, you can tell by the monotone hoodie.
Yeah, well, and it's always a dirty hoodie, too. I always call Belichick dirty hoodie.
So you're not giving the Patriots much respect.
Well, they just don't look impressive in their wins. They win. And the reason I even have them in the top, I probably would have had one of the one-loss teams in instead of the Patriots, except they're just that well coached. And as much as I hate Belichick, and who knows, they could be cheating again. I mean, it's entirely possible. As much as I hate Belichick, they win. Yeah. And that's the thing. I mean, no matter who's playing quarterback,
You have them at number five because you hate the coach.
Well, I have them at number five because I respect the—I mean, I'd have them at number 32 if I could, you know, but you got to respect them. I mean, they're winning with nobodies.
Yeah, and true enough. At least in terms of their receiving core.
Yeah, well, I mean, they still have Tom Brady, and their defense is pretty good.
They have Danny Amendola.
Yeah, well, Amendola, he's been a pretty good replacement for Welker. Of course, Welker just picked right up where he left off. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. So how about your number four? Okay, let's see if it works this time.
Number four. Third down, goal to go at the two. 17-7 Kansas City, 5:50 to go in the game. They bring McCluster in motion. They fake to him. Sprint out action. Wide open. Touchdown. Jamal Charles. The same play they ran against Dallas. Touchdown. Kansas City.
This was against a heck of a football team. I know what their record is. But I also know they have good players and good coaches. And it's just a blip in the screen for them. They'll bounce back here off that. I've seen them do some amazing things over time, having to compete against them the last few years.
Yeah, there they are, the Kansas City Chiefs, my number four team. I never would have thought that I would have the Kansas City Chiefs ranked at number four heading into the season. But Andy Reid and Alex Smith are getting it done.
Well, you can hear Andy Reid getting fatter in that interview. You just hear him.
You thought he was expanding while talking?
Well, but there's something going on, and they might not stay in the top five for long, but for now, they've definitely earned it. And I actually have them a little bit higher than that. My number four is the Seahawks.
Yeah.
And I'd have them higher, except...
You're really underestimating the Seahawks.
Yeah, I probably... They just haven't looked that impressive, especially last week. I mean, they just... But they get it done.
Well, they've had a number of games on the road. They just beat the Houston Texans, which were a quality team in Houston. And they came back to beat them.
Yeah, I think they're number four. I mean, that's pretty good. And I foresee them being much higher by the end of the year.
You think so?
Yeah, I definitely think so. So how about your number three?
My number three is the New England Patriots.
Okay.
I have them up there basically based on track record and deserved history.
I can't really argue with it. I mean, I had them a little bit lower, but they've earned where they're at.
And Tom Brady and Bill Belichick, until you knock them off, they pretty much deserve a spot in the top three. What about you?
Okay.
Now, here's where it gets tricky. Number three.
Play action to Thomas. Breeze pumps. Going to throw right flat. Wide open is Watson diving for the pylon. And he is in. Touchdown. Ben Watson with his first touchdown as a Saint. Good for 4 yards. And the Saints extend their lead.
Everything that could have gone wrong for us last year went wrong. And, unfortunately, we're having the ball bounce our way a little bit this year. But also, we're playing good football. We played some very good teams. Obviously, been able to play well at home here. We got a little road stretch coming up at Chicago, at New England before the bye. So it's not going to get any easier. It only gets tougher. And we've got to continue to get a little bit better each week.
Yeah, the New Orleans Saints.
There you go.
And honestly, I think I would have moved them up after last night. But
you probably would have.
Yeah, when I turned my list in, though, yesterday, as of yesterday, I had them at number three.
And now you might put them ahead of your number two team?
Yeah, I
potentially.
Think so.
Who is your number two team?
My number two team is the Chiefs.
You got the Chiefs at number two?
I had the Chiefs at number two.
That's insanity.
Well,
Chiefs are the second best team in the NFL?
Right now, I think so.
Ahead of the Seahawks?
Well, as of 6 a.m. yesterday, when I made my list, yeah, I thought they were. I think the Saints are number two now, but the Chiefs have earned it. And again, it's one of those situations, they probably won't be there for long, but right now, they're there.
All right, well, that's interesting. Here's my number two team.
Thanks a lot. Number two.
Holiday from 6 yards deep in the end zone will bring it out. Holiday over the 20, 25. Look out, here we go. 30, 35, Trenton Holiday down the east sideline, steps out of a tackle. 30, 25, you're not going to catch him. Trenton Holiday to the house.
We're one quarter into it. I'm pleased with where we are. Truth be told, you can't be better than 4-0 after four games. So, we're just trying to continue to, prepare and do the things necessary to get ready for each week, and including Dallas this week.
I got Denver at number two. That's Bronco coach John Fox.
Speaking of insanity.
Well, the reason I have Denver number two is because they lost handily to my number one team.
Well,
in the preseason.
And of course.
Of course, that was just the preseason.
That was just the preseason. And that means my number one is Denver. Your number one is.
And the number one.
Turn. Blitz is coming. Shelf's got to get rid of it. The ball is picked up. It's Richard Sherman. He's going to go down the far sidelines. Are you kidding me? Nobody's going to touch him. 10-5. Touchdown. Seahawks.
I love that.
54 yards and the defense does it again. Richard Sherman. Holy smoke.
It was a play we saw before. They like to go to the flats and short yardage. Even when Shaw's under pressure, that's his release valve. And I just went to bait him. Our safeties did a great job of disguising it, and I was able to bait him into the throw and get my hands on it and just go. Man, that was just a lot of fight.
Well, you have 15 seconds to defend yourself on this one.
Yeah, the Seahawks, their defense is unbelievable. And they're riding a steep wave of momentum. They beat Denver handily in the preseason. That's why they're my number one.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's going to be the AFC Championship game, I think.
You mean the
Super Bowl. I mean, I forgot the Seahawks aren't in the AFC anymore.
Yeah.
I'm stuck in the 80s. And with that, we're out of time. We'll see you guys tomorrow. News Talk 1270 KIML.
For the latest on the show, follow Don on Twitter, at The Don Carpenter. News Talk 1270 KIML.
Happy Government Shutdown Day. I'm Todd Starnes with this Fox News and Commentary next.
Hi, this is Stephen Baldwin. If you could have a bright movie star smile in 5 minutes, would I get your attention? I'm on TV every day, and that's why I use Power Swabs. It's clinically proven to whiten your teeth in 5 minutes. The secret is a tooth detergent that lifts the stains right off your teeth. Power Swabs whitens teeth on the average 2 shades in 5 minutes and 6 shades in 7 days. To try Power Swabs, call 1-800-663-7516. That's 1-800-663-7516.